Hi, I'm Mr. G.S. Saini, Director, National Civil Defense College, National Fire Service College. Today, I'm going to talk about training for disaster preparedness. Friends, we have been learning about disaster management in many platforms and spheres. But what we need to really invest is in our own preparedness. And disaster preparedness, primarily which needs a bit of investment, and that investment must be contributed towards regular training on various levels of responses which we need to bring about for all hazards which may be present at a given time and place. Training, as we look at, is mostly a way of developing a human resources, and managing such human resources becomes a higher amount of priority in any disaster situation. As a preparedness stage, we need to look at selecting the best and also recruiting suitable people to ensure that the right people perform the right tasks where they are needed to. We need to develop these people to ensure that the organizational benefits are realized to their full potential. We have many organizations which are working in the disaster response stage. We are many organizations which support the administration during recovery stage, and such organizations need to have people who can ensure that they can work to their full potential to bring about normalcy in the affected zone. Training will enable people to perform their assigned duties to a satisfactory standard. These standards we need to not only develop, these standards which we need to practice on ground will bring about a better management of any disaster situation and ensure faster recovery. The management of resources need to be also looked at for the point of the new type of hazards that may be potentially created or may be posed to us. There is a change which primarily we need to bring about, and these changes can only be successfully implemented in case we have better technology, we improve our work practices, and we also have a better way of improving our environment. Performance discrepancies may result in unacceptable standards of performance. And performance discrepancies always result in huge amount of losses. And this needs to be ensured that we do not have these discrepancies and inculcate or develop unacceptable standards of performance. There is a process by which we learn. And learn for disaster preparedness, learning for disaster preparedness has many aspects which we need to understand. We know that people will invariably have knowledge. They need to get skills. They need to also build abilities so that they can handle situations which may be extraordinary in nature. We must understand that learning will take place. It can take place by study, by experience, or being taught. Life experiences itself, in fact, whenever spoken about and shared with others, brings about a good amount of learning for people to understand that how they reacted during a situation. What precisely we want, and the people are required to understand that learning is something which we believe some committed to the memory. And when we talk about learning, people need to remember what they went through and what they learned. Observation brings to mind the old expression about don't do what I do, do what I say you should do. Unfortunately, this is not what happens. And many a times in our own education fields, we do teach, but sometimes we believe that may not be practicable. And this is where the learning itself will be an expression which needs to be amended, needs to be seen in a new paradigm where we have to inculcate things and people so that they believe what they can perform and what they can do. Receiving instruction requires presence of somebody who has not only the necessary information or skills to impart, but also be able to willing to take up or give instruction. The training part primarily builds upon this. Learning may also take place without it leading to any worthwhile improvement in job performance. And there are many aspects, primarily in our own educational fields, we learn, but maybe they may not worthwhile bring about any improvement on our job performance in a given area, but certainly it doesn't mean we should not learn those things. There is a big difference between learning through the educational means and what we believe training when bring about. And when we define training, basically means learning directed towards a specific performance, which we refer to as training. And learning which brings about a specific performance has to be inculcated in each and every person as a continuous manner. The definition itself, on a larger perspective, can be a planned process to modify attitude, to bring about knowledge, to build skills, and through learning experience, we try to achieve effective performance in an activity or a range of activities. The performance in the work situation is to develop the abilities of the individual to satisfy current and future manpower needs of the organization. In the present perspective, as we have huge amount of hazards which are surrounding us, and we do have new levels of damages which are being exhibited by phenomena which can lead to much, much bigger damages, we need to understand that the future manpower needs need to be more specialized in various aspects which needs to be brought in for creating normalcy in the disaster situation. And for that, there are many reasons which can be attributed for including training as a component in our preparedness. People may never be able to perform the task properly is the first reason which is given. We see that in a daily basis whenever a road accident happens. Many people do not turn up to assist any person injured in a road accident. And the basic reason behind that can be attributable to people not knowing what to do in such a situation. And this leads to either improper way of handling victims and subsequently can also lead to a further damage to the individual. They may harm themselves or others. Maybe the other reason, they need training. And if not, proper training not given or proper learning is not undertaken by the individual, they in result may harm themselves by doing wrong things. They are likely to learn a way that may be completely wrong. When we talk about CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation may be a practice which everybody talks about what they need to do. But unless he learns that what is the correct way of administering CPR, he may not be able to perform it correctly and may rather be more damaging to the individual than of any help. There are reasons for training which bring about understanding the consequences, and primarily any consequence of a wrong performance may result in poor quality, equipment downtime, and even complaints coming from various departments or various areas which may bring in bad publicity for any organization. Once a task is learned wrongly, it is very difficult to unlearn. We had an experience which we normally saw that an individual asked as a question that in case an injury is borne by an individual and he is bleeding, to avoid any amount of difficulty for further administration of any medicine, a wet pad should be applied on that wound. And subsequently, the reason given for applying a wet pad was that it doesn't get stuck and can be removed easily when higher amount of healing has to be done by a doctor which has to be attending to it. But invariably, the wrong part here is that in case you apply a wrong a wet pad, you are inducing infection to that particular region, and moreover, sogging of the capillaries will lead to lesser or prolonged way of treatment to that particular wound also. And this is where we need to avoid wrong methods by which we should not be adopting such methodology by which we may rather be creating more harm to ourselves and to others also. The training justification primarily comes in when we have to look at rapid development to a full job performance. We need to increase our output. We need to have an organization which may be very small, but certainly they need to build upon, and accordingly the output needs to be expanded to those areas where we may not have any experience. There has to be an improved level of service, there has to be improved quality, and moreover, all these aspects will lead to less wastage of time, materials, personal and money. In a disaster situation, we all understand time is critical. When time is critical, we need to be pacing up as early as possible, reducing less amount of time taken to reach a scene and to providing assistance to the victims. We also need to bring in materials which may be aptly needed for the victims, not forgetting that unnecessary materials at that particular time may not be of any use. Justification for training, we'll also look at better utilization of our equipment, better utilization of all personnel, fewer accidents by the people who are assisting the victims, reduced costs, reduced need for supervision, better identification of personal potential, improved morale, and the best of all is early recovery. We always speak about recovery, but recovery all depends upon how well we are prepared. The larger amount of preparedness of a community and a resilient community will reduce the amount of recovery for each and every sphere where a disaster strikes. And this is where we need to understand that the complete amount of training programs need to inculcate effective means by which the better specialized people can be brought in, and subsequently a fewer amount of damages to the personnel, to the equipment, and to the performance can be ensured. The performance itself of each and every individual during a disaster situation, whether it's individual or community or even to a responder who is going to respond to a situation, will all depend upon a prolonged and a deliberate attempt to first plan and design the training, which will depend upon the assessment needs, training needs will establish as to what type of training we need to have. And when we prepare our disaster management plans, the training needs will percolate down from these plans, and implementation will ensure that we have a better performance which we can display when such situations come in. As far as the disaster training is concerned, at the preparedness stage, training has to be involved at three stages. At the very basic stage, some people may not have even basic knowledge of certain skills that will be necessary. So a basic and a general level of training has to be organized, where awareness can be given, knowledge can be built, and certain amount of skills can be developed subsequently, so that people learn how to survive in an event. Performance will relate back to tell us that which person was performing which skill better, and that primarily can also encourage the organizations to develop various teams to perform collective tasks. These teams will be put through service and team training, so that these teams can build up better cohesion, better coordination, and accordingly can ensure that they respectively work as a team when it comes to working at a disaster situation. Once these teams have been trained, the teams need to also come together and work as a combined force. And that is where combined training will become necessary. And these combined training has to be ensured through exercises. Exercises, in fact, happen to be the best option available for training the local people, and especially in the context of adult education. Exercises is one which primarily gives a lot of leverage to the individual to react, to feel as he is giving a solution. And that is where primarily the level of acceptance to the training is much, much higher when we have such type of scenario building exercises which we normally indulge in. Refresher training will be something which will be inherently needed, because what we develop as a basic knowledge, what we develop or learn as a team training needs to be refreshed. Newer guidelines which need to be also inculcated, needs to be practiced, needs to be known to people, and needs to be shared with others. The training for disaster preparedness, mostly, in fact, as I said, exercises are a method of combined training which we evaluate the skills of all the trained personnel in simulated situations and judge as to how well they'll be able to perform in coordination with other various levels of teams. There is a need for methodological approach, and we should avoid any accidents or injury to the participants. Now, these exercises primarily can be by building stories. These can be based on realistic scenarios. These can be built on realistic incidents which may have happened. Throwing questions to the community or to the audience primarily to understand and to gauge and respond to those situations where they may be also involved at a future time. At the beginning stage, the exercises primarily can take on a level of exercise which can be in an enclosed space with a classroom or in a hall, And these normally are termed as tabletop exercises. Now, tabletop exercises are often used as a prelude to any larger or complex exercise. And they have an advantage which primarily can not only test, can also involve the participants directly. The participants can test and rehearse inter-agency communication and coordination. And moreover, there will be information management methods and the flow of information that can be analyzed within a classroom by the observers and by the controllers of the entire management system to understand how people are going to be reacting during a situation. Managers can plan how the resources should be mobilized. Primarily, in fact, building up on stories or building up a particular incident will relate back to how each and every team will perform, how the managers will be able to coordinate, what type of agencies primarily need to be mobilized, what type of resources to be called in, and how these resources are going to be performing, and what type of directions to be given to each and every team member. That can be practiced as far as tabletop exercises are concerned. The tabletop exercises can also rather be taken up as a practice where problem solving skills and also coordination discussion can happen, and disaster and emergency management strategies can be developed. There are many key agencies which come in at various levels, and when we engage in various exercises, or rather we get too much involved in a particular task, we tend to forget that there is a stakeholder or there is an agency which is waiting for our directions. And this is where key agencies and stakeholders can, first of all, they can become acquainted with each other. And at a tabletop exercise, the interrelated roles can be better understood, and each and every agency can understand their respective responsibilities and can share with the others so that they work more cohesively and collectively when situation happens. We need to understand that we have to have a unified command structure which we need to develop. And if a unified command structure has to be practiced on ground, we need to listen to somebody who has been authorized by the district authority to become the incident commander. And for that, we need to understand that tabletop exercises gives a strength to how and what level of intervention has to be brought in by the incident commander, what expectancy is related from the incident commander to the various teams. Computer simulation exercises is another component for training, which primarily is abundantly available and can be used for practicing incident response system in a realistic environment. There are computer game systems which can be utilized where simulation of an incident is carried out, and this simulation usually can lead back to people responding to various situations. Practicing of interagency communication and coordination is something which can be developed, and accordingly each and every level of agency can contribute and give assistance, give its own version as to what level of role they can play. It can also make us understand all critical roles of players and their functions. And moreover, this will develop a team spirit amongst all the responders. Team spirit at the computer simulation level primarily can be brought in before we take them onto the ground and field level to understand what level of performance will be essentially required. When we look at exercises, there's a huge amount of preparation which may be needed. Tabletop exercises, you need to build up a scenario, you need to extract information, you need to look at realistic situation which happened, and based on that a storyline is built up. And based on the storyline, you tend to primarily ask questions or pose questions at each and every stage as to what level of response is expected out of the participants. Whereas a full-fledged exercise, which may come as an emergency management exercise on the field, has to be objectively look at what is the total outcome or objective which we need to achieve. The scope has to be defined, because we must understand one thing. We cannot simulate a real disaster. We only have to exercise the performance of the disaster teams which are going to work in a scenario. And for that, we need to develop the scope up to which the exercise will extend and what expectancy can be brought in. There has to be a timetable which has to be prepared, and the timetable will define at a given level after the alert is given as to how the other level of agencies will respond to the situation. There is a staff which is needed for monitoring the entire amount of exercise, and this staff needs to be selected. There has to be a director for the complete exercise. You need to have a chief empire and staff and a chief producer and staff. The director overall will be responsible for the development of the exercise and seeing the implementation of exercise. The chief empire and staff will be acting as observers, which will rather evaluate the level of performance of each and every individual in the exercise, and subsequently will report back to the director as to what level was people were able to perform. Whereas the chief producer and staff, based on the scenario built up by the director, will be instilling and inducing the environment, creating simulations on ground so that the same level of environment can be created as to what may be experienced during any particular real disaster. There are preparations which may be necessary. Spectators, observers is one factor where every exercise must be involved. Remember, when we prepare for any disaster, we are looking at our own perspective as to what we believe may be a necessary thing for preparing. But when we have a huge amount of spectators and observers, they can provide good amount of inputs which can strengthen our own plans and also tell us as to how much amount of more elements need to be added. Media involvement is necessary. Media, we always believe, tends to be very negative. We do talk about rogue media, and we may believe that it may be still existing, but there is a positive media which we need to know, and media involvement in such exercises is taken up as a threshold level where confidence can be built amongst the media about the capacities which we are exhibiting, and subsequently in showing the media, look, these are the level of things which you are putting in place so that lesser amount of impact can be visualized, can be expected in any huge disaster. Exercise orders will be needed. Each and every functionary, each and every agency need to identify, need to know how and what level of preparedness they need to undertake for the exercise, what will be the level of disruptions which can be expected, and these will all come in the exercise orders, which will tell realistically that how people will be reacting to situations. Financial arrangements is inherent part of each and every level of activity. And for exercise, also financial arrangement will have to be made, not only looking after the participants, but also for the people who are producing and exercising the entire amount of emergency exercises. They need to be also provided with basic succor so that they can carry out their tasks. Conducting an exercise will involve various factors, and which needs to be judged against the performance of individuals with regard to punctuality, with regard to handling of casualties, with regard to the dress they were wearing, whether it was comfortable, with regard to delays and mistakes they performed, and whether the exercise level took into account what level of aids or realism or faking of casualties, so that people still will be able to perform as realistic as possible to what they would experience during disasters. Functions of staff will be necessarily required to be defined and given to each and every person and staff member so that he understands how he need to perform or function during such exercises. Friends, each and every exercise throws off enough amount of challenges and also outcomes. Lessons learned during any particular exercise must be shared, and we must have a debriefing session. And when we have debriefing, or normally we talk about hot wash, these sessions primarily bring about all the lessons what we learned, and each functionary or rather the empire staff must bring in and highlight such things for a better assimilation and better preparation for the future disasters. Post-drill discussions will engage participants, resource persons and other stakeholders to identify the strengths and weaknesses in the current emergency management plans, and subsequently will recommend to the authorities as to what more measures to be taken for strengthening our plans. They can also be used to identify gaps in capacity building and also to identify the training needs for the community, building up training curriculum, and as well as including more amount of people to come and be part of the preparedness strategy. Friends, analyzing the complete exercise on its own or the emergency management exercise, that needs to be taken up as a whole, and recommendations have to be made for further improvement. That overall primarily will be the prerogative of the director to understand. The director of the exercise will disseminate not only the lessons, but also after consultation with the employer and staff, we'll also make recommendations for any improvement in the pattern of exercise that was organized. These factors primarily bring about to us as to how and what type of benefits and outcomes we would expect. Each and every exercise or each and every training, rather, which is brought about, has to be looked at bringing in benefits of enhancing awareness in public, awareness about various hazards which they may be posed with, various level of things, changes which are happening in the environment. They need to understand about what level of participation they need to engage in, and also need to build upon on opportunities given for more learning, where good amount of environment has to be created where people can come, be part of it, and learn a better way of surviving and being part of the administration, so that the collective community resilience can be also built. Performance assessment and improvement will be the best part of outcome which we would like to take up after every disaster exercise. Our disaster preparedness exercise usually assesses not only performance of the responder, it looks at the efficacy of the department, it looks at the efficacy of the administration and the district as a whole, invariably involvement of community as to what all improvements more needs to be brought in. Testing coordination and improving our organizing abilities is a benefit which certainly must accrue. Coordination challenges primarily can be best tested during an exercise, and these in case resolved will have lesser amount of conflict and lesser amount of problems for any particular disaster or event which may happen in the future. Friends, when we look at any particular disaster, preparedness is the key to all our future survival. And better preparedness all depends on what we look at the hazards and how these hazards can pose a tangible risk to us. And if we have a strategy to reduce our risk, we will be able to build a better level of learning, a better level of skill development, a better level of awareness in people, so that they not only survive but also have the capacity and confidence to be part of a team and assist the administration during any particular disaster. Thank you very much.